pleasure to introduce a good friend of ours. Dale has written or edited, contributed to more than 15 books on G.K. Chesterton, including The Apostle of Common Sense, The Soul of Wit. Some of these are back on the back table. The Complete Thinker, In Defense of Sanity. He's the president and co-founder of the American Chesterton Society and the publisher of its magazine, Gilbert. The American Chesterton Society serves as the support organization for over 60 Chesterton societies around the nation. Dale created and hosts EWTN's television series on Chesterton, The Apostle of Common Sense, which is in its seventh season. Most recently, because he and his wife, Laura, were bored managing their household of six kids, Dale co-founded Chesterton Academy, a Minneapolis-based high school that in its fourth year was ranked as one of the top 50th high school, Catholic high schools in the country in its fourth year. How Dale discovered Chesterton. Now, that's an interesting story. Some of you will remember Larry Norman, who was an early Christian rock and roll artist, and actually gave a concert here at Spring Arbor College. Well, Larry Norman was married to Dale's sister, Pam. And one day, Larry Norman's was looking at what Dale was reading and said, well, if you like C.S. Lewis, then you should try G.K. Chesterton. And he told them why. And we know that Dale took him up on that challenge because he was reading Chesterton on his honeymoon. He originally came from sturdy evangelical Baptist roots. His grandfather was a beloved Baptist medical missionary in India. And so we can imagine that it was no light matter when Dale converted to Catholicism in 1997, imitating his mentor, G.K. Chesterton, who converted to Rome. Now, I want to read something that is a description of Dale that's appeared in print. So I'm quoting, no matter what you choose to say about him, you will necessarily leave something else out. But whatever the case, his faith is not something that can be ignored. As an apostle of common sense, he has chosen to defend simple basic truths. The first things, the permanent things. As a speaker, writer, and thinker, he is enormously clarifying. In an age of relativism, he speaks in absolutes. He speaks the truth without uncertainty, without wavering, without embarrassment, and without the anger and pride that befoul even the truth. He speaks with graciousness and goodness and humility. They will recognize those words because he wrote them about G.K. Chesterton. But they're true of Dale because Chesterton has been Dale's mentor, as much as Dale has been my mentor. So I want you to help me welcome to Spring Arbor University for the third time, Dale Ahlquist.
Well, Robert, thank you for that kind and wonderful, really too long introduction. Unfortunately, now I can give a much shorter talk, so that's great. Well, I promised this afternoon that I would give an introduction to Chesterton this evening, because I skipped the introduction this morning. So let me just briefly tell you a little bit about Chesterton, and then we'll go into the topic tonight. He was, during his lifetime, one of the most well-known writers in the entire world. And he lived from 1874 to 1936. He did really all of his writing in the first third of the 20th century. During that time, wrote 100 books, wrote introductions to 200 more books, books of all different subjects from history, philosophy, theology, art, literary criticism, and economics and politics, novels, plays, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of poems and detective fiction, but he was primarily a journalist. He wrote for the newspapers and other periodicals in both London, where he lived, and in America as well. And he wrote at least 5,000 literary essays. So I just want you to think about that number for just a minute there. In fact, I want you to go home tonight and write an essay. Most of you probably have to do that anyway. And then tomorrow, write another essay. And then that will be two essays, okay? So all you have to do is write another 4,998 essays. And if you do that, you could just write an essay every day for the next 15 years without taking Sundays off. You'll get pretty close to that number. And then you can start in on your novels and your detective fiction series that you wanted to write. And that book on Thomas Aquinas that's been burning a hole in your mind. You can write that one too. But Chesterton was so prolific that he could actually write two essays at one time. He could write one out in longhand and dictate an entirely different essay to his secretary at the same time. So you see, that would cut your writing time in half. And because he was always writing under a deadline, everything he wrote was under a deadline, which is like a college student, right? Oh man, I gotta get that essay in the next 15 minutes. I better get started. He would always be concentrating on these things, and those little details in life, those little things that kind of consume our attention, he let his wife take care of those. And so his saintly wife, Frances, would make sure that he got up and got dressed and got fed and got to his appointments and made sure that really every detail of his life was attended to, because he was totally capable of doing it himself. And once in a while, she was not able, for one reason or another, to accompany him, and then disaster would ensue immediately. And there's the great story of him stepping off a train in the days before cell phones and going to a telegraph station and sending a telegram to his wife. M. at Market Harborough, where ought I to be? Chesterton said, absent-mindedness is simply present-mindedness about something else. There's the story of him getting a cab and giving the cab driver an address, which was across the street. Or the story of him hailing a cab to get a ride to the offices of GK's Weekly, the newspaper that he was the editor of. Didn't know the address. The cab driver had to stop at a newspaper stand and buy a copy of the newspaper. And then, of course, getting out of the cab was the great adventure for Chesterton, because he was about 6'4", weighed about 300 pounds. And one story has the cab driver struggling to help him get out of the cab. So perhaps if you get out sideways, Mr. Chesterton. And he said, I have no sideways. Chesterton said, you cannot be fat in secret. And he said he was the politest man in all of England, because he could stand up on a bus and offer his seat to three women at one time. He said he was also the jolliest man in all of England, because there's such a lot of me having a good time. And yet this overgrown elf, who used to abuse children at birthday parties by catching buns in his mouth, This was someone who wrote an essay in the Illustrated London News that inspired Gandhi to start leading the movement for the independence of India, and who wrote a novel that inspired Michael Collins to start a war with England for Irish home rule, and wrote a book called The Everlasting Man that was read by a young atheist named C.S. Lewis, who found that his life had totally changed by the time he finished reading the book. He said it was the first reasonable defense of Christianity that he ever read. And as he said afterwards, a young man who's serious about his atheism cannot be too careful about what he reads. And so this was an enormously influential writer. And yet, shortly after he died, he disappeared. People stopped reading him within a couple of generations. Most of the world had forgotten about who Chesterton was. And we've had the great privilege of seeing a revival of interest in his writings in the last 10, 15, 20 years. And now it's starting to really take off. And I've had the great privilege of being part of that revival. And I think that there's several reasons why Chesterton went into eclipse and why he's coming back. I think one of the reasons he went into eclipse is a real obvious reason. When he died, he stopped writing. And you know, we know him through his books, but during his lifetime, he was known primarily through his journals. And when he stopped cranking out journalism, people stopped reading. And so he survived through his books. Of course, the most popular thing he wrote were these Father Brown stories, these detective stories. And but the other reason is that after World War II, a sort of darkness descended on the face of the earth, and the world was sort of shocked by how much evil it suddenly had encountered. And a writer like Chesterton, with his joy, with his hope, was simply not what people wanted to hear. They wanted to sort of comfort themselves with darkness. And the dark writers were the ones who never read, the existentialists, the ones who were kind of using meaninglessness as a form of explaining the meaninglessness of what people were encountering in the world. And so that's another reason. And then, as a Christian writer and as a Catholic writer, he certainly fell out of popularity in our colleges and universities, and people stopped reading him. But for all those same reasons, that's why he's coming back. People realize that joy and hope is exactly what we need. And Chesterton is this writer full of joy, full of hope, and certainly prophetic. They're seeing that what Chesterton wrote 100 years ago seems to be even more true now than when he wrote it, when he said things, well, simple things like that fallacies do not cease to be fallacies even if they become fashions. And that to have a right to do a thing is not all the same as being right in doing it. And the world will not argue about what is evil, they'll argue about which evils are excusable. And he says, a new philosophy generally means in practice the praise of some old vice. And we need a religion that is right where we are wrong. And if there were no God, there would be no atheists. And of course, poets have been mysteriously silent on the subject of cheese. You know, things like that people need to hear. And this one, angels fly because they take themselves lightly. And the other reason, is his Catholicism has suddenly become something very interesting because just within the last month, the Catholic Church has announced that they are beginning to open the official process into Chesterton's potential canonization. And it really has caught a lot of people by surprise because he doesn't fit the image of what a Catholic saint is. And certainly he didn't for me when I started discovering Chesterton. My idea of a Catholic saint was that she was generally a 14-year-old barefoot girl. And the idea of a 300-pound cigar-smoking journalist with a halo is really an intriguing idea. And it shows that Chesterton, the idea is that he practiced a heroic virtue in his chosen profession. It really was a light in the darkness. It's someone who lived out the gospel in a secular setting. And truly among, you know, the voice of secularization in the world, the press, because he didn't write for the religious press, he wrote for the secular press, and yet always managed to point to the eternal, to point to God. And so tonight we're going to talk about what Chesterton's approach to a liberal arts education is. I've called Chesterton my most recent book, A Complete Thinker. And that's really what a liberal arts education tries to do, is develop complete thinkers. People who not know everything, but know how to think about everything, and know how to come to the right conclusions with the data that they are given. The Chesterton's definition of education is simply truth in the state of transmission. It's passing the truth from one generation to the next. That's what education is. It's a real simple concept. That's what education means, passing the truth from one generation to the next. And he says the whole point of education is that it should give a person a set of standards, eternal standards, which can be used to judge fugitive standards. But we have this backwards, too. In our schools today, we change standards as often as we change the light bulbs. Of course, now with the new light bulbs, we change a little less frequently, but still. The whole thing is that Chesterton says the modern mind cannot make up its mind. It has no internal philosophy, no internal reference point. And the irony is that the more doubtful that we have become about the value of philosophy, the more certain we have become about the value of education. So that any time a politician opens his mouth, he says, education, which means I will pour your tax dollars into education because I believe in education. Sometimes the lip syncs off on that, but the point is they keep saying the same word over and over again as if education is this magical power, but they won't say the real crux of the matter, what is actually being taught, because remember the definition is truth in the state of transmission. Chesterton says the more doubtful we are about whether we have any truth, the more certain we are, apparently, that we can teach it to our children. The smaller our faith in doctrine, the larger our faith in doctors. So that's the big paradox. And he says also, Chesterton says, the one thing that's never taught is that there is a whole truth of things, and that in knowing it and speaking it, we are happy. There is a whole truth of things, and in knowing it and speaking it, we are happy. So in a liberal arts education, the standards really are truth, as I just said, and then the other two great classical ideas of beauty and goodness. Truth, beauty, and goodness. That's really the essence of a liberal arts education. And of course, we encounter in the modern world the exact opposites of those three things, which are falsehood, ugliness, and evil. But those are the obvious opposites. The real danger are the more subtle versions of the opposites, which would be ambiguity and vulgarity and relativism. Those are really the way the truth, beauty, and goodness have been undermined, by ambiguity, by vulgarity, and by relativism. And so I want to talk just quickly about truth, beauty, and goodness, and what Chesterton has to say about those things. And, you know, as some of you know, the famous question, what is truth, was uttered by Pontius Pilate in the presence of truth itself. And that's really what the problem in the modern world is that we attack the very idea that there is an absolute truth. And that is just an attack on the truth that was made flesh, the incarnation. God has come in the flesh. He said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Everything is somehow connected to that truth, if it's true. Chesterton says that Christianity is just a bunch of metaphysical nonsense. Well, then repeating it simply means repeating a bunch of metaphysical nonsense. But if it's true, then it is a truth that affects anything and everything. And he says, things can be irrelevant to the proposition Christianity is false, but nothing can be irrelevant to the proposition that Christianity is true. So that truth informs all other truths. The school that I had the great privilege of helping found back in Minneapolis, Chesterton Academy, our curriculum is a very integrated classical curriculum. And the idea is that the subjects are not only connected to each other, they're all connected to a central truth, which is the incarnation. All stories are telling the same story. And whether those are stories in literature or stories in history, they're all connected to that historical fact that Jesus entered the world, that God became flesh, that he died and rose again. That truth affects everything else. And so art is connected to that truth. And so is philosophy, and so are the sciences. The sciences recognize that we are looking and observing and trying to understand the created world. And that by knowing and understanding God's created order, we can become better people for that, by understanding God's created order. But science is based on observation, which is the same principle of art. Art is also based on observation. Both are based on understanding perfect proportion. And it's to the second concept of beauty. Chesterton says beauty is perfect proportion. It's having everything properly in its place. It's knowing that the big things are big and the small things are small. That the important things are really important and the less important things less so. That everything has its proper proportion, and the world tends to get the proportions wrong, and that is why the modern world is so ugly. We make something beautiful when we love it. When we don't love it, it's ugly. And so much of the modern world is ugly because we don't love the modern world. We also don't get the proportions right. Jesus pointed out the whole problem with the misunderstanding of the law. with the Pharisees when he said that they strain at a gnat and swallow a camel, right? Chesterton was good at pointing out what are the gnats and what are the camels. Because the modern world gets these things wrong. That's why in the modern world, abortion is legal, but smoking is illegal. Because we've got everything completely out of skew. We have a misunderstanding of our proper use of God's creation, and therefore we don't see the beauty, and we don't have the proper balance. Chesterton says, we who are mature and wicked have constantly to be reminded that beauty is beauty, that kindness is kindness, that courage is lovable, that lilies are white. Beauty can be an absolute. It can be certainly a joy in itself. And beauty, he says, is a fact. And harmony is a relationship between the facts. And art is born when the temporary touches the eternal. When the shock of beauty is when that irresistible force hits the immovable post. And he says the true poet is ultimately dedicated to beauty. And then he also says that beauty is unanswerable, and that beautiful things ought to mean beautiful things. Beautiful images, he says, are shadows of the one real beauty. And all things worth having, such as health, beauty, happiness, and virtue, are all, without exception, things produced by the right proportion between things. And he also says this. He says, unless the sky is beautiful, nothing is beautiful. And you think about that. He's getting, what's he saying there? What's happening? Unless the sky is beautiful, nothing is beautiful. He explains, unless the background of all things is good, it's no substitute to make the foreground better. So in other words, we live in a beautiful world that God has made. God has given us beauty as our background. And everything in front of it is really the decorations that we have made. You only decorate something that's beautiful, says Chesterton. You can't decorate something that's ugly. And then there's this connection, his great connection between beauty and goodness, is he says, art, like morality, consists of drawing the line somewhere. It goes back to this idea of proportion, that art has limitations. And truth is understood within the lines. Beauty is understood within the lines. Freedom is within the lines. He says the essence of every picture is the frame. So art, like morality, is this consistency between art and morality. And he says goodness is the highest thing in the world. And man is never at home except in goodness. And the whole object of poetry and mysticism, the whole object of all religions and of all philosophies that are not invented by the devil, is to make us value good things. And then he says the whole point of deprivation is that it sharpens value. A lot of our art, a lot of our literature, points to truth and beauty and goodness by showing falsehood and ugliness and evil. Sometimes those are the things that point to truth. It's the falsehood that points to the truth. It's the ugly thing that points to the beautiful thing. It's the evil thing that points to the good thing. And of course, when we deprive ourselves of those things, then we appreciate their value even. And that's why there's the very important Christian principle of fasting. You give up something good in order to appreciate it more. When you deprive yourself of something, for instance, in the practice of Lent, you don't give up a bad habit. People say, I'm going to give up biting my nails for Lent. Well,
you're not giving up a virtue by your nails, unless your nails are providing some certain nutrition that we didn't know about. People give up the thing that they really enjoy the most, because that's what the act of sacrifice is. And the sacrifice, as Chesterton points out, does not make God any better. We give our best to God not to make him better, it's to make ourselves better. That's why we do it, and we give them the very best we have. And it's sacrifice that points to truth and beauty and goodness. And Chesterton also points out that the hateful things always mimic the good things. Satan is always aping God. And Satan knows the truth. And that's why he's so clever in the way he deceives us, because he makes evil look like the truth. And then, of course, there's that great line of Chesterton's when he's writing about Charles Dickens. He says, "We believe as Christians that you can't have too much of a good thing. But the modern world thinks you can have too much of a good thing, and that's a blasphemous belief, because that at one blow wrecks all the heavens that men have hoped for." Because that's what heaven is about, is it's about so much of a good thing that we can't even begin to imagine. Heaven lies beyond our imagination, and its goodness is more than we can comprehend. So when we approach the liberal arts, those are the values that we're seeking, but how do we go about it? Well, we do it through, obviously, the great stories. We can talk about these facts and these ideas in a straightforward rhetorical way like I'm doing it now and boring everyone to death. Or we can tell stories. We can point to these truths through the great works of literature that have been given to us through the great artists across the ages. So at Chesterton Academy, we start the ninth graders off with the Iliad and the Odyssey and the Aeneid. Three great epic poems. And Chesterton says, we read these great works over and over again. We read the Iliad, he says, because all life is a battle. We read the Odyssey, because all life is a journey. And we read the Book of Job, because all of life is a riddle. And these great works of literature tell the story, and they tell it in a way that the truth comes alive in a multi-dimensional way. And the student can discover it for himself, just get inside the story. We study Dante, and we go through that great journey through heaven, through hell and purgatory and heaven, to see all the aspects of the consequences of our actions. And Chesterton has this great line. He says, it's not always wrong to go down to the lowest promontory and look down on hell. It's when you look up at hell that a serious miscalculation has probably been made. So then along with the ancient literature, we teach the ancient philosophy, and then we teach the Old Testament alongside those things. We teach the arts. We give the arts as much emphasis as the sciences. We don't do anything to weaken the emphasis on the sciences. But art is not an elective. All of our students have 4 years of art, and they take drawing and painting. And so by the end of their high school career, they are copying masterworks with the oils. They all are in choir. They may come in with no voice at all or a foghorn that they claim is their voice. But by the end of the time, they're singing Bach and Mozart. And they may not become professional singers, but they're going to be very pleasant to stand next to in church.
Again, 4 years of a required dead choir. And then they have 3 years, okay, they have 1 year of speech and faith, but then 3 years of drama. So they're all in three plays while they're in high school. And that gives them, the whole idea is that art, behind the concept of art is the incarnation. It's the Word made flesh. We have these great ideas, now let's expose them to the world. Let's show the world our great ideas. Let's proclaim them. And we learn the different ways of proclaiming them. And obviously when a student gets up on stage, he gets the confidence of standing and declaring the truth. And so they have 3 years of drama. And then they have 4 years of philosophy. And then the literature continues to mirror what's being taught in philosophy and theology. So we expose them to some great works of literature and great works of art. And this is how they get a complete education, become complete thinkers. That's what the liberal arts is really about. We learn the truth, but then we have to learn how to defend the truth. Because the truth is under attack in our world today. It's completely under attack. And the world attacks the idea of anyone claiming to have the truth. They make you sound intolerant or narrow-minded for declaring that what you're speaking is the truth. They say there's something wrong with dogmas, that you're not being open-minded. And Chesterton says, well, you know, dogmas are what humans do. Man is the animal that makes dogmas. Trees have no dogmas. Turnips are open-minded. The whole purpose of opening the mind is like opening the mouth, is to shut it again on something solid. That our mouth was given to us not just to ask questions, but actually to answer them as well. And we don't have truth unless we connect to the ultimate, to the eternal. He says, if you take away the supernatural, what remains is the unnatural. And so Chesterton, you know, loved defending the truth, and he did a great job of it. You know, when Jesus sends out his disciples to preach the gospel, he tells them to be as wise as serpents, but be as innocent as doves. And wisdom and innocence, that combination is what we have as Christians. And G.K. Chesterton really epitomizes wisdom and innocence. He has this goodness about him, but he also has a very sharp wisdom. And wisdom means not compromising the truth. Innocence means not compromising goodness. And people are drawn to goodness. That's what they're drawn to. And goodness should not be confused with something that's soft or passive. Because defending the truth sometimes means fighting for the truth. Sometimes we're called to fight for the truth. And he said, Chesterton said, one of the best things in the world is a good fight. And he says, we look back at his life, you see that he was always arguing, always defending the truth, always in a good intellectual wrestling match. He says, I remember once arguing with an honest young atheist who was very much shocked at my disputing some of the assumptions which were absolute sanctities to him. And at length he fell back on his question, which he delivered with an honorable heat of defiance and indignation. Well, can you tell me any man of intellect, great in science or philosophy, who accepted miracles? And I said, well, with pleasure, Descartes, Dr. Johnson, Isaac Newton, Faraday, Newman, Gladstone, Pasteur, Robert Browning, as many as you please. And to which my young friend made this astonishing reply, oh, well, of course, they had to say that. They were Christians. So first he challenged me to find a black swan, and then he ruled out all my swans because they were black. The fact that all these great intellects had come to the Christian view was somehow or other proof that they were not great intellects or that they had not really come to that view. And that's why Chesterton was sometimes disappointed by
the lack of the intellectual level of the arguments against Christianity. And as Christians, we can't be intimidated by the arguments, because most of them are really bad. It's really easy to point out the weakness in the atheist argument. And the agnostic is a little worse because he's so squirmy. The atheist is as if he's made up his mind. But the agnostic just simply wants to not ever make up his mind. But really, they argue dishonestly because everybody has certain things they believe. And every proof begins with some assumption. And the true skeptic really cannot even begin an argument. Chesterton says the true skeptic falls through floor after floor of a bottomless universe. And so we can't be afraid of these things, but that's why it's good to have a solid theology, because he says that is actually a product more practical than chemistry. It's good to be able to have that answer really every question that comes along. But we're afraid to discuss our faith. And the modern world has made discussing our faith a very inhospitable thing to do. Chesterton says religious liberty is supposed to mean that everyone's free to discuss his faith. In practice, it means hardly anyone is allowed to mention it. So those are the keys to the liberal arts education. I was just going to say one more thing, and then I would be happy to take some questions here. I was going to mention about miracles, independent miracles. It was one of the things. And I'll do that. Chesterton, he maintains the reason why people don't believe in miracles is that they have a dogma against the miracle. He says the reason that he believes in miracles is that there's evidence for them, and he believes the evidence. The skeptics only don't believe in miracles because they won't accept the evidence, and the reason they won't accept the evidence is because they have a dogma against miracles, and their dogma is materialism. And the materialist is simply not free to believe in miracles. His dogma prevents him from believing in miracles. There must always be a naturalistic explanation for everything. But sometimes the naturalistic explanations become more unbelievable than even the miraculous ones. And the place where that's most evident is in the story of Christ himself. And it's where Chester makes the great argument for Christ, that people will say, well, Jesus was a great teacher. He wasn't the Son of God, he was a great teacher. Well, Chesterton points out that if he were a great teacher, he would never say that he was the Son of God. That's the one thing a great teacher would never do. The other great teachers throughout history, and even those who were founders of religions, the one claim they would never make is that they were God. It means that when Jesus made that claim, he was either lying, or he was crazy, or he was the devil, or he was telling the truth. Those are the only options. The one thing you can't say about Jesus, the only option you don't have, is that he was a great teacher. If that argument sounds at all familiar, it's because C.S. Lewis uses the same argument in Mere Christianity. And of course, he got it from G.K. Chesterton. And that's why, if you read Chesterton, you don't need to read C.S. Lewis. Which is what my brother-in-law said to me, and then created the monster that you see before. All right, I'll be happy to take some questions. Chesterton and his wife did not have any children. They had really hoped to have a large family. She talked about she wanted to have seven beautiful children. And after a few years, they realized that she was having a physical problem and not able to conceive. They met with many doctors at a certain point and realized that they weren't going to have children. So they filled their house with other people's children. And they had kind of the equivalent of foster children.
who stayed with him for extended periods of time, he loved to have the chaos of children around him. Both adored children. There was a true sense, a true heartbreak for both of them that they couldn't have children. Yeah, well, yeah, there's no heresies. He had one, he had a brother and a sister, both of whom died without having children as well. So there's only descendants and cousins. Yes.
Which book would you recommend for someone who is reading Richard Dawkins?
Well, the first thing is they need to stop reading Richard Dawkins. the Chesterton book that if they haven't read any Chesterton, I always recommend that they start with my introductory books, The Impossible Common Sense or Common Sense 101. But the Chesterton books that really handle the atheist arguments quite well are his two great works of apologetics, Orthodoxy and The Everlasting Man, which is really amazing works of apologetics, very creative in their approach to the Christian truth. And so they're both tough books to read if you haven't read Chesterton. You have to really spend time with both of them. But they're just, the rewards are great. You need to read Orthodoxy 3 times. And but it's a short book, fortunately, yeah. So 3 times. And then Everlasting Man at least 2x. But The Everlasting Man is where it just brings everything to bear. It shows how when Christ enters history changes completely. But the way he sets it up is just absolutely amazing. It's not so much from a historical point of view, but from a cultural point of view, and how Greek and Latin culture and Hebrew culture all converge, you know, on Jerusalem, and religion meets philosophy for the first time. It's really an astonishing work. Yes?
Does your school do anything with Chesterton's economics, outlines?
Yeah, we senior year we go into economics and we give a taste of distributism. For those of you who aren't familiar with that idea, Chesterton was a great critic of both capitalism and socialism. He pointed out that, you know, so many of our modern problems are directly a result of industrial capitalism in the late 19th century and all the reactions to it, the worst reaction being socialism. So that capitalism creates socialism, and really the two have continued side by side, big government and big business. He calls them Hudge and Nudge. And Hudge and Nudge are sort of conspired to take away the rights and the freedoms of the common man. And whereas capitalism is the main idea is behind capitalism's individualism, the rights of the individual, and socialism emphasizes the rights of the community, distributism emphasizes the rights of the family. And it's saying that the family is the main unit of society, and everything in society must be centered on and nurture and protect strong families. And so he sees individual ownership and individual proprietorship or people in their own business for themselves, not as employees, as the key to a strong, stable society, both a stable economy and really a stable culture as well. That's the essence behind distributism. And it's an idea that's gaining a lot of attention now because people are starting to realize that things aren't working and all the present economic explanations are not explaining anything. What else? Did you start reading that Shakespeare book yet? Yeah, no, don't turn around.
Tonight.
Good. Yes.
What would you say would be the best collection of his essays, to which has some of the better ones, or?
Yeah, I helped edit a collection of essays this last year called "In Defense of Sanity." It's 60 plus of what we call the best essays, but we were just using a dartboard. You know, that's how we do it. And. Yeah, Chesterton's essays are remarkable because, as I said, he was a mystery writer, but his essays are kind of written with the same scheme of a mystery story.
It's the first sentence kind of just grabs you, like the corpse on the middle of the floor kind of gets your attention at the beginning of a murder mystery. And so she presents the problem in a very compelling way, and then he starts to give you the clues. But in a good mystery, none of the clues really are as obvious as they should be. You know, they're kind of leading you in a different direction. Even though they're all true, every clue is true, everything he's telling is true, it's taking you not where you're expecting to go. And then he shocks you with a conclusion that you just didn't see coming. And that's a good mystery, too. A mystery reveals a solution that's been sitting under your nose the whole time, but suddenly you see it for the first time. His essays have the same sort of punch to them. He leads you along in one direction and pulls the thing off. There you are. And you're, his essay on the jury system called The 12 Men. And he talks about sitting in the jury and watching the process of the court and being quite amazed and impressed by the lawyers and the judge and their professionalism. But he also realizes that they're all forgetting about the fact that that's a human being sitting there in the dock who's under trial. And that's why it shouldn't be up to the judge to decide his guilt or innocence. It's too important. It's up to the jury, none of whom are professionals. None of them who have any great understanding of law, but who understand what it is to be a human who's going through these things, and then they weigh the evidence. And he says, whenever the world wants something that's very important done, it doesn't use the specialists, it just uses the regular people. They just like they did with the jury, just they 12 common men standing around. He says the same thing was done by the founder of Christianity. That's the conclusion. You go, oh, I didn't see that one. Yeah, I didn't bring the copy. We can get that one off our website, In Defense of Sanity. Yes?
Sounds like you have a wonderful vision for secondary ed in the liberal arts. At an institution like ours,
it's too late.
That's clear.
College were set up to be the center of liberal arts, and it's very important that we keep teaching the classics and keep teaching the arts, and that we use those to balance everything else we're doing. And what's important too is that our students actually struggle with the texts and engage themselves into it, because the main problem is that we've come into things very passive, and we just want to be entertained, and we want all the work done for us. And the whole idea of sitting down and working through a text is such a sharpening experience for the mind, and that's the thing we can keep doing and emphasizing at the college level. Yeah. Reading Chesterton is another good idea. Well, all right. Thank you for your kind attention tonight. God bless you all.